We move on. We move, I suppose, northeast from both of those locations to Taiwan, or east. But anyway, definitely to the east. The title from Taiwan of our next presentation is Change Your Mind Before You Choose. Brain signature of changing food information on healthiness, sustainability to improve food choice. And your presenter for this finalist entry is going to be Chen Pingjing, and our alumna to introduce her will be Anna Szaletska. Anna and Chen, welcome.
Welcome. I would like to talk to you to very important issues to us, alumni group, as well as BCFN Foundation, which is sustainable food and our health. We all understand that there are many ways to improve current situation, which is not only contributing to climate change, but also is making us unhealthy. The way the food is produced, then transported, consumed, and wasted is very unsustainable. As alumni, we understand that the way Chen is proposing to change the way we eat food and shop for food might change the future. So please, let's listen to what Chen has to say.
You don't need a silver fork to eat good food. However, to choose healthy and sustainable diet, you need your brain processing the right information. What are the differences between these two pictures? In a modern society, the concept that the natural food means healthiness and processed food equals to unhealthiness is not true. The important issue to be addressed is how to choose processed food that ultimately promotes the continuous well-being of ourselves and our planet. So, what is processed food? Processed foods are foods with any deliberate change before being eaten. They can range from minimally processed food, like corn in a can, or the heavily processed food, like corn chips. Since minimally processed food has more nutrition left and requires less industrial process, the ideal diet is to include more minimally processed food. So, recently, the awareness of having enough food for human population and having good quality food for the next generation increases. The goal of my project is to let people enjoy the happy moment of eating, at the same time being healthy and being nice to the earth. The target is the general adult populations, and I will try to find a simple but effective way to encourage food choice with minimally processed food. But how can we encourage food choice with minimally processed food? First, we need to understand what happens in the brain when people think about and when people buy the food. And then we can try to change the concept and the choice through an intervention. Evaluative conditioning has been proved to be an effective methodology to change food choice, food attitude, and eating habits. I will use this paradigm as an intervention to strengthen the association between minimally processed food and the concept of healthiness and sustainability. The neuroscience technique, electroencephalography, detects the event-related potential generated by neural activities. I will use this technique to investigate the neural markers tracking food-related information. Investigating the neural signature not only strengthens the behavior evidence, but also provides more detailed information about implicit changes underlying cognitive process, even before the behavioral outcome. For example, the neural activity elicited by the conflict of showing a minimally processed food with the sentence, "it is unhealthy," can be the blue line. After the intervention, the elicited neural activity should be bigger than the blue line. And the bigger of the difference between these two neural activities means the intervention is more effective. Also, people who show larger differences of the neural activities are expected to choose more minimally processed food in a virtual supermarket game I use. I also want to see whether the neural activities can successfully predict the future food attitude and food choice toward minimally processed food. Here, I would like to share with you, this is my breakfast in Taiwan. Considering the globalization of food industry, but very different ingredient and eating habits around the world, an Asian student who studies in Europe probably is the suitable candidate to investigate and to compare the neural underpinnings of food choice in different social cultural contexts. So, I will include a sample from Taiwan in order to develop an applicable intervention for more people. So the application will be, for example, we can develop the apps that people can use without time and space limit. We can also create a game with the information and the food information in a real supermarket. We can apply it for food education and the therapy for this eating disorder, even for product development. I think my project is in line with the innovative nature of BCFN, yes, and the funds will support me with the equipment collecting data in Italy and Taiwan, more importantly, to develop the applications. Wish you a healthy and sustainable diet. Thank you.
Chen, thanks very much indeed for that. Well, Anna, you have your four precious minutes with your protege, your star.
Very interesting. Any questions?
I find difficult to understand how this encephalography is going to improve your attitude to educate the people to move towards more unprocessed food. How will you utilize this information for your intervention?
Okay. So I think that the electroencephalography itself is more like a tool than the solution. And I use it because we need to understand whether we, after the intervention, we really elicit the changes in the brain, and then whether these changes can predict the people's behavior. So we are not going to change people's behavior by using the technique. Instead, we use this technique to check whether our intervention is effective at a neural level.
Okay. Hi. Well done for making it this far in the competition. My question is about this notion of choice that you're using in relation to sustainability, because I would argue that there are billions of people on this planet for whom sustainability is not a choice at all. So how do you reconcile the notions, the parameters, the principles of sustainable development with this idea of choice? And I'm also wondering whether you've ever thought about the potential negative applications that such a process could generate if it goes in the wrong hands of a ruthless multinational corporation, for example.
Okay, thank you for your question. So the first part, I think I will answer that about how I define or how I find it a sustainable choice, right? So I think that nowadays there is a very big problem in food industry or food consumption, that is people are not aware of the concept. Because the food industry is human-centered. If the customer, they don't change their behavior, we can never promote a real sustainability or healthiness in a food in the food system. So here I just want to try to make it very simple, but it's very prompt. For example, if we just have the idea and we have a frequent, let's say, the exposure to the concept, if this intervention is really effective and it can really remind us again and again. And then if this intervention induces the change and the change predicts really the behavior, which means that through this process, we can really encourage people to make the healthier and more sustainable choice in this case. And the second one is about the usage of this method. I think that people who study psychology will know that one thing has the pros and cons. So really, it depends on how you use it. I cannot ensure that no one will use it in the wrong way. But from the other aspect, if we can use it in the right way, it can also strengthen, I mean, the beautifulness of this planet. This is what I think. Thank you.
Time for a quick, very quick question and a quick answer. In fact, 31 seconds.
Wouldn't you think it would be easier to check the effectiveness of an intervention just looking at the food choice in the cart of the supermarket at the exit without going through the recording of the brain waves?
I think that is because, as I emphasized before, the changes in the brain is the more implicit changes. For example, some people, if you ask them to choose food, probably they don't show any outward behavior. But if you do this intervention, probably it already triggers a little bit changes in the brain. And if, as we think, the people who has more changes in the brain, they are more likely to choose the food. And if we find someone who already triggered by the change, by the intervention, but not yet enough for him or her to process, this is the way we are going to work on. So which means that we can induce more changes by this intervention until the final behavior outcome is there. Thank you.
Chen, Anna, thanks very much indeed. We'll have to leave it there. I'm sure the connectivity between brainwaves and the supermarket checkout is a huge area, but our 4 minutes are up. Thank you both very much indeed.
Thank you.